we have gone above and beyond. What a good guy and what a bad guy is. What is classical wrestling? I can tell you. It has a place in history. It's important for learning as a young educational student. But what are we? We are the elite. We are the best on the planet. There is no good guy, no bad guy. There is no good, there is no evil, except for what is in our hearts.
Yes.
And what is in our hearts is this business that we love. So we will continue to own it. And we will continue to do it in our own very special way. And Tanahashi, oh yeah, I'm talking to you, you old fucker. You can't do anything about it. Your time is over. I run this promotion now. And when it comes to the world, you're looking at the best on the planet. Why? Not just because we're good. Oh, no. It's because of what's in here and what's in here. We do this for each and every one of you and for the good of professional wrestling. So grovel at our feet. Treat us like the kings we are.
Ooh.
In fact, let me go above and beyond that. Treat us. I'm going to say it.
What?
Treat us like gods.
Wow.
Ooh. You said kings.
I did.
You said kings.
I did.
Too often, people trying to drive a wedge between the Bullet Club.
Mm-hmm.
I hadn't been in the Bullet Club for 1 second, and it's, who's the leader? Who's mad at who? What's going on with Adam and Kenny? No, whoa, no. This is Camelot. This is a round table. Mediocrity loves company, and so does magnificence, and this is fucking magnificent.
Yes. Camelot, Cody? This is not Camelot, my friend. This is Valhalla.
Woo!
Yes. Too sweet.
Too sweet that. Too sweet that.
Beautiful.
Young Bucks, you have more pressing issues elsewhere.
Yes.
You are needed back in your home countries, my friend.
We are.
Give these people a message so that they can remember you by.
Tokyo, Japan, we will be back soon. We have to go home and pop the houses and sell some more t-shirts.
Yeah.
We have to go get a pump at the gym, make love to our wives, and have a couple more children. But we will be back. We'll be back more hung. We'll be back with better gear. We'll be back with better sideburns and better hair. We'll be back to
more important,
tan, too, right?
More importantly, broken hearties.
Ooh.
Broken
Ooh.
Matt, brother Nero.
Oh.
You cocksuckers.
Whoa.
We are coming for you.
Not if there's anything wrong with that.
What if Mom watches this?
No, punches.
Please, God, forgive me. But you know what?
What?
We are coming for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
April 1st.
Yep.
Lakeland, Florida. The best tag team on planet Earth. Versus you two, you pricks.
Too sweet?
Yeah.
Or?
Delete. Delete.
Too sweet.
Too sweet.
Too
sweet.
Get the hell out of here.
Elite.
The elite.
Break it down.
The elite.
The elite.
Break it down.
Second time.
Oyasumi.
Sayonara. Goodbye.
We had!
We had!
Say what?
Attack skills and vocabulary too. Coming hits in the distant edition is all brand new. You're through. I'm at the planetary in life, Doctor Who. So who?
Fuck your beef, no relief. I step on stage, girls scream like I'm Keith.
What's going on, everybody? Ring Time Pro Wrestling is back at it again. Keith is in the building. It is early. It is Monday. Unusual recording day for us, but I decided to take advantage of the day. I didn't have to work. Wrestling will be coming on for most of you guys in about an hour and a half, a little less than that, by the time the show is completed recording. Raw will probably be getting started. I decided to jump on the mic and talk a little bit. Why? Because Wrestle Kingdom is over. Wrestle Kingdom 13 is in the books. It was a crazy show. It was good. Not great. I mean, but a good show. And it had a lot going on. All the titles changed hands. And as far as we know, the Elite are done in New Japan for right now. And I say for now because I don't know how the future is going to play out. I don't know who's going to land where, and I don't know what All Elite Wrestling's promotional reciprocation is going to be like between them, ROH, and New Japan, right? Because it has to be something working with all three, because ROH and New Japan already have a working agreement with each other. So, contracts have ended, people have started moving, and now we're starting to see what the rest of the world is about to shape up and look like. Who should be worried? How this will affect the overall scope of what's going on? And I will say the health of the business is really good right now. That's what we know. What we know right now is that the business is as popular as it's been in a long time. We're not late 90s attitude era popular, but we are getting to a point where wrestling is cool again, and it's cool on the fringes, not just the hardcore core fans, which means a lot. It means a lot for podcasts like this because we get increased downloads because people want to know more about what's going on. People who have been out of the loop want to catch up. People who are in the loop want to know more. So we are going to provide as much information as we possibly can. So what I'm going to do this week, I'm going to get right to the recap. I'm going to go down the card, tear it down, give you my thoughts. Then I'll go to the news because there's a lot to unpack in the news. Priscilla Kelly broke the internet. I will give you my thoughts on that. Full disclosure, we know PK in these parts. She's homegrown. She's Georgia. I'm in Hiram. She's in Douglasville, down the street. So just understand, I'm slightly biased, but not too biased. And I don't think the stunt killed the industry. And I'll give you a point why what she did versus what Joey Ryan did is actually kind of different. But if you didn't have a problem with Joey Ryan, you shouldn't have a problem with PK. So all that will be discussed. So without further ado, let's get to this card. All right, so Wrestle Kingdom 13 goes down. I'm struggling again to see Wrestle Kingdom because there's server issues. So I had to go back and rewatch the first match, which technically was a pre-show match, because the show was listed that it started off at 2 a.m. Eastern time, which it did not. It actually started at 3. The first match started at 2, and then it was like an hour-long, 45-minute intermission. So, the first match. MVP defeated Suzuki-Gun, Chaos, and the Elite, or the representatives of those respective organizations. They are now the number one contenders for the Openweight six-man tag team titles. Good job. Then, still fighting. Had to watch a first part of the show in Japanese commentary because I couldn't get in on English commentary. Finally was able to break in later. I was using all my devices. I was trying to use my Chromecast, my Fire Stick. It was going crazy. Found out I was not the only one. New Japan was aware of those server issues, and they got it corrected. Now, some of you are like, oh man, that's a bad look. No, it is actually good. What that means is that way more people tried to log in and watch this show live than they expected. They did not have a server capacity ready right away to be able to accommodate all these people getting up at 3 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the morning, wherever they are, some earlier or didn't go to sleep, whatever it was. Like if you was on the West Coast, you probably just didn't go to sleep. Stayed up till midnight, started watching. Or you like me, you got off work early, got home, got you a nap, so you can be up and watch this and stick through it. Because, I mean, it's a long-haul show. But either way, it says, hey, more people wanted this than they expected. So, next year they'll be ready. And also, good job. You're increasing the audience. Which was what they wanted. Please don't believe that New Japan does not want to be a very strong presence in the United States. I'm not saying where they want to rank, but they just want to make sure they have a strong presence in the United States. They understand there's a lot of hardcore fans. They've heard about the tape trader generation, so they know that they got people who will be dedicated and watch this product. So, that's a good thing. Will Ospreay defeated Kota Ibushi. He is now the new Never Openweight Champion. It was a good match. Ospreay will pull a little weight, and I'm happy to see that. Still maintained his athleticism. I see he's still fine-tuning the game a little bit, so he still did a lot of stuff, but he did do some unrealistic stuff in this match, which I'm happy for, because the match with him and Ricochet, as good as the match was, some of the high spots just didn't make sense. Like, they were illogical, and they they was doing a game of what ups and shit that went too far, and it diluted like the meaning of the match. Once again, I understand that wrestling is not quote unquote real in the sense of like these are not shoot fights. These are not like actual combat. That being said, you have to work on the illusion and you have to do things that make sense so people can suspend disbelief. And Ospreay's matches sometimes just look like a gymnastic show, an aerobic show, and not pro wrestling. This looked like pro wrestling. Good job, him and Ibushi. What does Ibushi's future hold? I do not know. Because so many people connected to him, futures are up in the air. I mean, he's done. The elite are no longer around. This is just him. So we're going to talk about it. Bushi and Tagaki defeated Roppongi 3K and Suzuki-Gun, new IWGP Junior Tag Team Champions. Second title change of the night. That is a recurring theme. We thought Suzuki-Gun would keep the belts or have a nice run, or Roppongi 3K would get the belts back. And hey, Sho and Yo have been running that division, that junior division, for a long time. I mean, it's kind of like you thought they were taking the mantle from the Young Bucks, and this was who was going to be out there, but we'll see. Zack Sabre defeated Tomohiro Ishii for the British title. That is probably the one thing that we predicted correctly. This is Zack's third time winning the belt. Did not know he actually beat Brian Danielson for the belt, like, years ago. But there's the rest of the fact to what you learned during the night. Big surprise for me, too, with the tag team titles. Evil, and it's not, it shouldn't be a surprise, right? Evil and Sanada have been dominating the tag team division for about the last year and a year and a half in New Japan Pro Wrestling. An incredible tag team. I thought both of them had individual aspirations as solo artists, but they are still the team to beat as a tag team. They defeated G.O.D., Gorillas of Destiny, Haku Kids, and they defeated the Young Bucks to win the IWGP titles from Gorillas of Destiny. Now, the Bucks, this was their last match in New Japan. Their contract was fulfilled. Of course, we know they are officially signed with the Elite. They are all in early, so that doesn't need to be here nor there. They got put in this, because technically the match was supposed to be G.O.D. and Sanada and Evil. It's in Los Nagarabes, Japan. It was supposed to be those guys, right? And they petitioned, they got the Bucks in the match. People want the Bucks in the match. Perfect. So they got a proper send-off. And that was good. And it was in a match that was worthy of their stature. But Evil and Sanada got the tag team titles. Once again, recurring theme. Juice Robinson defeated Cody Rhodes. And he is the new IWGP US champion. This is his second reign with the belt. He won it back from the guy who beat him, Cody Rhodes. Also, eventually the whole Dusty's Kid thing. Juice has a lot of potential. I watched Juice for the last 3 or 4 years, and I'm really happy that he's starting to, you know, move along. It's a slow burn. You're taking your time with Mr. Robinson. But it looks good so far. Like, it looks like they're trending in the right direction with Juice. Beating Cody is a big win to not turn your belt. Will Cody be back to fight? We don't know. We know, once again, with them being the Elite, having their own promotion, and being able to start, he's going to be focused on that. He is one of the executives with the Elite, which I'm happy to see. Cody is making power moves similar to another Rhodes named Dusty. Dusty set Florida on fire. Dusty became a good booker. He was a good promoter. He worked that out in WCW also. He was a very creative man. Cody, I think, has a lot of that his father had. And he is going to get to express it now in his own promotion, where he's a partner and somebody who can have some major input. And all the top guys are his boys. So they're tight. So they'll be able to work together and figure this out. And the revolution has happened down in Florida. It's happened down in Jacksonville. Same way Dusty made the revolution happen with Eddie Graham in the Florida territory. Florida is the wrestling hotbed right now. MLW is killing it down in Orlando and got CBS attention, possibly getting some TV something out of that. At least always got it radio call. NXT, WWE is doing the whole NXT thing, the facility at Full Sail is down here in Florida, in Orlando. So the focus and then what they do with WNN and Live and Evolve, all a lot of that stuff takes place in Florida. So Florida is the place to be if you want to be a pro wrestler right now. I think you get a lot out of it. But backtracking, good job for Juice. Good job, Juice, getting back to the throne, man. Getting back to sitting on top of the game. So, with that being said, let's get to the next guy. Taiji Ishimori defeated Kushida for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight title. No clue, man. No clue Kushida was going to lose. I thought he was set for a long run. If anything, I thought Kushida would have been setting up to maybe go to the next level and like and get out of the juniors and start fighting for the other belts. But as we will see later, there's a different plan for Mr. Kushida. Jay White defeated Kushida Okada in a singles match. No belt was on the line. This is getting down into the main event section of the card. Here's what I'll say about that. He called it. I thought Okada was going to win. I thought this was like the return of the Rainmaker. This is it. This guy is coming back. He looking for his belt. He see his belt not too far in the distance. And here it goes. Not so much. The old school, new school beat the old school. And I think it means a lot for Jay White. It means a lot to him going forward. And this win is something he'll be able to reference when he's looking to challenge for that world title. Because I know he believes he should be very, very involved in how that picture plays out. And right now, he's proved he's deserving. He's going to be one of those people who you talk about at the top of the game. And he's going to be the top gaijin over there right now. That's it. It's Jay White. It's Switchblade. It's a Switchblade world right now. So let that soak in. The main events. This is, well, one was easy. So the IWGP Intercontinental title. Tetsu Naito beat Chris Jericho. I figured that this was where Chris Jericho finishes up his run. Now, Royal Street is Jericho may not be done with New Japan. He may be setting his sights up even further. The guy looked good. He worked good. He still got it. Then the idea was flowing back that, no, you know, healthy life and schedule and stuff like that. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen? So, Jericho lost, so we kind of do that. Jericho could sign with the Elite. Or we can see Jericho in 20 days at Royal Rumble. We don't know. One thing I say about Jericho, when I saw Cody doing it, when I saw Rey Mysterio doing it, he is one of those guys who is getting the best out of his wrestling life and not locking himself down, not signing, and just getting out and getting somewhere with it. So I appreciate that. Appreciate seeing it. But yeah, Jericho may that's something to check out. But if not, you know. Yeah. So, Naito's new IWGP IC champion. World champ. Now, I did call this one. Tanahashi wins G1. And you think, good for Tanahashi. Good winning G1, man. Good to get back in the mix. But I felt like his time had passed. I thought this would be the coronation of Kenny Omega. Because it's one thing when you win the title in another show, it's big when you don't win it even more. So, and having to live with it and all that. Yeah. So, Kenny Omega didn't get it done. Because one thing I can say, I feel like the big champions winning at the big events is one of my asterisks against The Rock. Well, The Rock has came into WrestleMania without the title, but he's never left with it. And I think you have to leave the stadium with it for people. But, you know, by that standard, to me, is had his status. So, I'll leave it alone. Anyway, yeah. Yeah. Tanahashi is the new champ. He defeated Kenny Omega. Kenny Omega has announced he's done with New Japan, and the rumors have been flying. So, what I'm going to do is say this. It was a good show. All the titles changed hands, which was interesting. Basically, they're setting for the reboot. They are ready for this thing to not shut down on them, and them still to be stable and make it work. And, you know, that'll work itself out. And, I mean, this company has bounced back. It survived talent raids before. You got to think, in 2016, they lost Gallows, Anderson, AJ Styles, and Shinsuke Nakamura. And they moved on without missing a beat. They have a good farm system, and they pay good money, so people will want to wrestle there. And they have working agreements, so they can get guys from ROH and stuff like that. And we're not sure if the Elite are done with New Japan. So, with that being said, I'm going to get us on a break. And I'm going to bring Dusty in because we talked about Cody. And now it's news and notes. I will do birthdays because I haven't done birthdays in forever. And, yeah, we're definitely going to talk about what's coming down the pike, who's doing what, and what we think. Also, if you watch Raw tonight, I ain't a fan of Hogan, but he's probably going to do the Mean Gene thing. And that's worth watching. R.I.P. Mean Gene. But we're going to do this, and we'll be back.
Here is the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty, your fans welcome you back, man.
First of all, I would like to thank the many, many fans throughout this country that wrote cards and letters to Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, while I was down. Secondly, I want to thank Jim Crockett Promotions for waiting and taking the time, because I know how important it was, Starrcade 85, it is to the resident fans, it is to Jim Crockett Promotions. And Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, with that wait, got what I wanted. Ric Flair, the world's heavyweight champion. I don't have to say a lot more about the way I feel about Ric Flair. No respect, no honor. There is no honor among thieves in the first place. He put hard times on Dusty Rhodes and his family. You don't know what hard times are, Daddy. Hard times are when the textile workers around this country are out of work and got four or five kids and can't pay their wages, can't buy their food. Hard times are when the auto workers are out of work and they tell them go home. And hard times are when a man has worked at a job 30 years. 30 years, they give him a watch, kick him in the butt, and say, hey, a computer took your place, Daddy. That's hard time. That's hard time. And Ric Flair, you put hard times on this country by taking Dusty Rhodes out. That's hard time. And we all had hard times together. I admit I don't look like the athlete of the day supposed to look. My belly's just a little big. My hand is just a little big. But, brother, I am bad, and they know I'm bad. And there were two bad people. One was John Wayne, and he's dead, brother. And the other was right here. Nature Boy Ric Flair. The world's heavyweight title belongs to these people. I'm going to reach out right now. I want you at home to know my hand is touching your hand for this gathering of the biggest body of people in this country, in this universe, all over the world. Now, reach it out, because the love that was given me, and this time I will repay you now, because I will be the next world's heavyweight champion on this hard time blues. Dusty Rhodes Tour 85. And Ric Flair, Nature Boy, let me leave you with this. One way to hurt Ric Flair is to take what he cherishes more than anything in the world. That's the world's heavyweight title. I'm gonna take it. I've been there twice. This time when I take it, Daddy, I'm gonna take it for you. Let's gather for it. Don't let me down now, because I came back for you, for that man up there that died 10, 12 years ago and never got the opportunity.
to see a real Wolf champion. And I'm proud of you, and thank God I have you. And I love you. Love you!
It's always good to hear a little Dusty. And that Hard Times promo is deep, man, because it never gets old, and it reaches right to your soul. I mean, I can imagine little kids when he like, I stretch my hand to touch your hand. And they reaching up and they putting their fingerprints on the TV and their mama yelling at them because they don't want them touching the screen. And look, they just cleaned off the TV. They don't need you putting fingerprints all on it. But that being said, emotional. Emotional resonance and connection always works in professional wrestling. So let's get to birthdays. Birthdays is easy. We haven't done birthdays in a while. Today is January 7th. That means yesterday, WWE Hall of Famer Jacqueline celebrated a birthday. She turned 54. Ludwig Borga turned 55. Chavo Guerrero Sr. Had a birthday today. Today is January 7th. Alicia Edwards turned 32. Oh, man. I'm still doing stuff by 2018 clock. I'm sorry. Jacqueline turned 55. Ludwig Borga turned 56. Dude, I still think 2018 when I'm doing the math. It's 2019. Tomorrow, January 8th, Tuesday, Bushwhacker Luke will be celebrating the bad birthday. Reach out to Luke Williams. He's on social media. He runs a gym down in Florida. Somebody you can always check out. Bad Luck Fale celebrates a birthday. He turns 37. Wow, if you was born in 1982, you turned 37 this year. People getting old. Mind you, I'm creeping up on 40. Chris Masters, the masterpiece, turned 36 today. Well, he'll turn 36 tomorrow. I'm sorry. So that's birthdays. So, here we go. Let's get into the news. Let's break it down one by one. So, I would be remiss to not discuss the Priscilla Kelly incident. For those of you who do not know who Priscilla Kelly is, Priscilla Kelly is an independent wrestler who wrestles out of Georgia. She wrestles at various different promotions. She is a little bit goth. People compare her to Paige, but I think she's a lot more crazier than Paige, and I think she would take crazy as a compliment, so it gives you an idea. She did a stunt in a bar on an indie show, and full disclosure, I think it was absolutely disgusting, right? I think the idea and execution of it was meant to be that way, though. Like, here's the funny thing. The spot was meant to be disgusting. Here's the thing. Like, it was tasteless. That was the point. So let's get that out the way. Like, sometimes I think we get caught up with like, oh my God, this is a thing. It happened, right? Now, what happened? So, her opponent is laid out on this chair. She is beat up and she can't move. And she said, hey, you said you want the tutor. I'm going to give you the tutor. She reaches into her tights and reaches up in her tights to her women areas, people believe, which, I'm going to give y'all an inside secret. This is all a work. It was fake. But anyway, she pulled out what appeared to be a bloody tampon. Now, it wasn't real blood, but She pulled it out and she stuffed it in the young lady's mouth. Now, that broke the internet. And many people had a problem. Jim Ross was pissed. I'm sure Jim Cornette hates it. And I haven't even seen his response, which I'll probably listen to the show Thursday and I'm sure he will go off. Road Dogg told the lady that she was a low moral character, and she's one of the reasons why people hate the business. Here's what I'll say. I have not seen that much outrage against Joey Ryan. Joey Ryan does a dick spot. He has made his dick famous all over the world. Joey Ryan does a spot where, hey, somehow the opponent grabs his crotch And then the guy, his magical crotch flips the guy over. That is hokey dumb shit, right? Now, I'm not saying either one of them, but that's stupid. All right. Now, Joey Ryan also has a thing where he has a lollipop in his trunks. He pulls that lollipop out of his trunks and sticks it in the dude's mouth. Now, let's get it close. Both are disgusting, right? If you ask me which one I'd rather have done to me, you ask me do I would be stabbed or shot, right? If we talked it over prior to the match, if it's my job contingent on me doing this, I quit, all right? Just give you the levels of how I feel about this. That being said, I think the fallout that Priscilla Kelly got from this probably was unfair in context to what we've seen on the internet. One, and to be fair, the people who have supported her actually have done things that I think are legitimately worse. She got a lot of support from the ECW crowd. She got a lot of support from Tommy Dreamer. Here's the thing. I think getting body slammed on thumbtacks might be slightly worse. Why? Because that shit hurts. Now, if it was real blood on the tampon, you got me, right? Was it in her vagina? No. Was it probably next to it? Yeah, it was in her trunks. Now, the way she simulated it, she made it seem like she reached up there and grabbed it. Here's the thing. It's for the shock and awe value. She succeeded. She got, but I don't think she did it for buzz. Here's the thing. She did this show, and it wasn't like kids there either. Like, let's get that out the way. It was at a bar. So if your kids are at a bar, you're fucked up as a parent. All right, but it was at a bar. 21 and up. That was the show. It was for a little promotion, and the promotion didn't air this footage. Somebody did it with a camera phone or something like that, because we can't do shit without pulling out our phones. So, in this day and age, since people can't do shit without pulling out their phones, it went viral. It went around. And here's what I'll say. It happened. It happens. It's kind of like if I saw something that was weird at a strip club. Hey, man, shit happens weird at strip clubs, I guess. That is kind of beyond it. But here's the thing. It was a simulated act. It was meant to be disgusting. It was meant to get the pop and the raw emotion. Now, if it becomes a consistent spot, we probably got a problem. But I don't think it's death to the industry. Mainstream fans won't see it. And honestly, the more people are seeing it is based on people who keep sharing it, who claim they're disgusted by it. Look, man, you ain't that disgusted if you put it on your page. I have not shared it on the Ring Time Pro Wrestling pages or on any of our social media platforms. I don't think I've shared. No, I take that back. I did retweet it. And I also showed my support for Priscilla Kelly, and I've offered her an invitation. The microphone is always open. PK, if you are listening, the mic is always open. If you want to talk about this, if you just want to shoot off, because, hey, this is what I think it came down to. People didn't have a problem with the Ryan spot, but they had a problem with the Kelly spot, and try to give me every mental gymnastics scenario for why one is different than the other, and they're not. Here's the thing. It involved her vagina, and since majority of wrestling fans are male, we have problems with vaginas. It sounds kind of counterintuitive because we like vaginas, but we only like them in a certain context. So the idea that it was a bloody tampon or anything like that, we hate blood and we hate the idea of the period, da 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 da. But many of y'all are thankful that that thing shows up every month because it means that y'all ain't got to pay no child support. So here's the thing. I'm not that weirded out by it. And I don't know why I'm not that weirded out. Maybe if I was at the bar, I'd be a little weirded out. I don't know. Would I let my kids see it? No. Would I encourage my kids to do it? No. That being said, I also wouldn't encourage them to jump off the back of their roof or on top of somebody. I mean, some of the shit I've seen in some backyard wrestling videos, nobody got hurt. That's the biggest part. Man, look, nobody got hurt. And it was a spot where nobody was going to get hurt. It got shock and awe, and nobody got hurt. And damn it, if you can't have it, I don't know what else. But that's my two cents. Like, I think a lot of people are more outraged because it involved a vagina than the idea of it was disgusting. Like, it was disgusting, and that was the point. And it was disgusting by concept. It wasn't necessarily disgusting in application. I pretty much just like some red Kool-Aid or something red that simulated it to look like blood just to give people the idea. Because here's the thing. It doesn't even have to... I don't even know what she used. And she's probably not going to admit that. That's too much inside baseball. But here's the thing. You just got to get a red color of anything. Because once you pull that spot and you pull it out, people's minds are going to turn it into blood. You don't have to worry about that. The mental switch in our head will turn it into blood and you'll be there. So, this is my thoughts. So, I'm going to give that to you and leave it there. So, New Japan. Talk about New Japan surviving. Kenny Omega said he's out. Where is he going? Nobody knows. Here's the rumors. He's going to sign with the Elite. He's going to be with his brothers. The guys who he have built this rep. I think it's a better idea for him to be with the Elite than the WWE. And this is what my thoughts are. Because I think Kushida's going to come to the WWE also. If Kushida comes, he'll end up regulating the 205 Live, and he might get lost in the shuffle. Kenny Omega. If Kenny Omega comes, and he comes with this high... This is the word of the street. So apparently, they offered him a 5-year deal worth all this money, like $23 million per, which means they'd have to use him, and they have to use him in a high spot. I don't believe that shit for a minute. Maybe with incentives and all kinds of other stuff, you can get that high. But nah, man. I don't think they paid John Cena $5 million at his peak. You can't really believe everything you read on these blogs and these sites. And the idea of this. They're not that desperate. They're still the number one pony in town. I read an article, Vince is worried about the Elite. No. Here's one thing we have to stop doing as wrestling fans, too. Every time there's an upstart promotion, every time something has some name notoriety, we automatically put it as a competitor for the WWE. And no, right? If a new drink come out, a new soft drink, it don't mean it's a competitor for Coke. It just means it's in the marketplace. It doesn't become a competitor for Coke until it gets about 20 or 30% of the marketplace. Because right now, Coke's probably dominating probably 80% of the marketplace. So they're, you're not in a competitor's seat yet. Pepsi isn't a legit competitor to Coke. Hence, ROH is probably the number two promotion in this country. Not a legit contender. TNA at its all-time height was not a legit contender. WCW was a contender. WCW could threaten something and get some people to... And I mean, the way things set up... If I have to make a choice of spending money, then, you know, I have to go one way or the other. None of these people are that. They are just people who are enjoying the growth of a market. This is something we should celebrate as wrestling fans. Let's not try to get anybody put out of business. Let's support everybody and have as much of the business as we can have. Give these young men places to work, hone their craft, get better, and produce better product. What will push the WWE is if these things got popular and people stuck with them, and then they would have to, just like with the Attitude Era, they had to adjust. That would work. Personally, selfishly, I would like Omega to go with the Elite. I would like to stick with his brothers and continue the revolution, because what they've started and what they've done has started wrestling on his head. They have got American fans engaged in Japanese wrestling at an all-time high. They have gotten people watching other promotions at an all-time high, whether it's PWG, whether it's ROH. And they're fit for today's era. So they're young. They understand how things work with technology. So they'll be open to doing things that our traditional wrestling promotions probably wouldn't try right away. Shahid Khan's son, Tony Khan, is going to be running it. He's putting up the money. Also, every time a billionaire gets into wrestling, he's not going to put all his billions into wrestling. Like, it's... I need y'all to do some math and some counting and understand business. It's kind of like this. If you owned a real estate company and you bought a McDonald's, you are not putting the $23 million that your real estate company has into the McDonald's. You're not. That's not the goal. Now, a billionaire did that one time. He put a lot of money into it. But that billionaire had like 17 revenue streams. Okay? He saw it no different than when he bought the Atlanta Hawks, when he bought the Atlanta Braves, then subsequently the Thrashers, which didn't last long because of things. He was spending money because he wanted to be competitive. He thought that's how you dealt with wrestling, right? And he owned networks. The man owned television. He had TBS, TNT, CNN, Headline News. So he could carve out time in one of his prime network slots to put them on. That saves a lot of money. It's a good spot for them. That's all I'm saying. It's a good spot. He absorbed all the production costs. The profit and losses wasn't necessarily a major concern for him because he was making so much money off the other stuff. So, that being said, that was the only time they were able to contend. And what they did was they paid monopoly money to guys who were a little older, longer the tooth, but had better name notoriety to get the thing really off, to take it to the next level, to where it was knocking it, to where it was competing to the point of, I mean, they always were competitive. It would, and they probably could have, the point of what I'm saying is, where the WWE felt they were in trouble was different than when they were just a solid competitor, where they had to compete with, because it was good that they had a place where talent could grow, where they could go back and forth, da-da-da, and it was good when, for the most part, wrestling was separated still geographically. So, at its height, WCW still was very popular in the South. WWF, at its height, was still very popular up North. And they didn't, the streams didn't cross as much. Now, we're in a whole new world where, once again, we watch wrestling in foreign countries. I watch CMLL whenever I want to. I can watch AAA. Get the Pluto app. P-L-U-T-O. It's a free streaming app. They have channel 218. You can stream AAA all day long. Cast it to your TV if you got a Chromecast. If you got a Fire Stick, then you just download the Pluto app. They have a channel dedicated to Impact Wrestling, which it shows Impact Wrestling shows, old and new, and it shows some of the classic pay-per-views. They just purge your content. So, if you enjoy wrestling and you just got a free time, download the Pluto app. I recommend that. That's a fun time. But the point I'm getting at is that you can just watch and see anything you want when you want to see it. So it's a little different. Now, I think that's very helpful for the Elite. I think it's very helpful that they will be approaching things through newer technologies and understanding. Just be at places where the WWE isn't. And having that presence and using their name notoriety to get more things. SoCal Uncensored have signed with the Elite. I've heard All Elite Wrestling has taken meetings with ROH and New Japan, saying do understand the strength of partnerships and keeping a partnership together. One thing the WWF won't do in the near future is have working agreements on an equal level. They will do working agreements how they do now, where like, oh, in the UK, yo, Progress and, you know, a few different promotions, hey, we'll work with you. And, you know, we'll lend you some talent every now and then. Evolve over here. We'll lend you some talent every now and then. But basically, y'all just a farm system. So before you get to NXT in either country, you can work in these indies. We'll keep an eye on you. Hey, if we fire you, you still can work in those indies, and we'll keep an eye on you. One of the things to help with Drew McIntyre, he was in TNA. They didn't watch him in TNA, but TNA had to let him work and evolve because TNA let you do indie dates because, hey, they can't pay you enough to keep you full-time, so they let you do some indie dates to kind of supplement your income. That guy kept going to evolve, and they was like, all right, we're going to do that. bring this guy back. He looked good. He just sharpened up his promo skills and everything. Impact Wrestling just caught on this year. Like, in the end of 2018, the end of it. When it was like, hey, man, LAX might wrestle Street Profits, and we can't have that. So, because if they lose, then we just lost. Our main roster guys just lost to their developmental guys. That ain't going to work. So, but WWE never does, like, because here's the thing. If ROH did a deal with WWE, they would want it probably on equal footing. And WWE doesn't see them that way. Fair enough. They're not. New Japan would definitely want equal footing, and WWE doesn't see it that way. Now, I will argue New Japan is an equal. Now, so New Japan and ROH work together, and they work together as equals. Nobody's going to do that with WWF right now. Because WWF is not going to structure themselves that way. So, it'll be interesting to see how long that'll last also. So, if these other promotions keep working together and just putting together hot shows and not abusing the idea, and if they put the money up, keep costs low. We'll see. I think Double or Nothing goes down January 8th. So, that'll be interesting. NXT TakeOver goes down January 12th. In the UK, we'll get some preview shows going for some of that stuff and recaps. Some, we'll be recording. We'll be around. If you've noticed, ringtimeprowrestling.com, if you go to the site, there are updates, man. January, I would say it's been updated at least 4 or 5 times in the 7 days that it's been in January. So, we're doing better. We're strong. We're committed. Also, I may have a new writing assignment. I'll tell you about the website later. It's supposed to be a popular website. I don't know. It'll be short stuff. It won't have anything to do with wrestling. It won't have anything to do with sports. But I appreciate if y'all came and supported it. So, I'll give you more details later. I got to watch a show tonight and then do a little recap. So, that's going down. I thought like I almost lost power. But apparently, I hadn't touched the screen in a while because I'm sitting here talking. But with all that being said, I'm about to shut it down. I'm trying to think, did I miss anything in news and notes? I talked enough about Priscilla. I talked enough about SoCal's sister, Kenny Omega, Kushida, and different guys leaving New Japan and how they survive and they still put on a good product. And they've set a lineup for their most recent, or their next big show coming up. New Beginning. Good show. And they've announced the card. So, I mean, it's going down. Night 1 is February 2nd. Night 2 is February 3rd. And, man, it's loaded. And you'll see some new faces. And you'll see some old faces. Tiger Mask going to be in the building. Taka Michinoku going to be on the card. King of the Michinoku Driver. The Bullet Club is going to be in the face. Tama, Tonga, Chase Owens, Takahashi, Tomohiro Ishii, which they got 2 Japanese guys in the Bullet Club now. So, you know, that kind of stuff is going down. We'll be there. Zack Sabre is wrestling Evil. Sanada is wrestling Suzuki. Things are going down. Okada and Tanahashi going to be in a tag team against Jay White and Bad Luck Fale. They're going to be all right. So, and I want to see how long does Okada Tanahashi bromance last? I don't know. But all that's going down. We appreciate y'all for listening. Hopefully, we can get more stuff like this. More shows in less time. So, y'all don't have to sit on it for a whole week. And we'll be back. Keisha will be back in the mix. And we'll get it going. With that being said, we love you. Peace. Thank you for listening in the new year. And that's 2 shows within the first week of the new year. I'm telling y'all winning. We're back. We're strong. And we're going to have a bomb 2019.